Morning, everybody.
Morning.
Welcome to worship on this beautiful Transfiguration Sunday. This is the last Sunday of Epiphany, and Lent begins this Wednesday on Ash Wednesday. I mentioned earlier that we're not going to have worship here in the sanctuary on Wednesday, and that's correct. But since that time, I've decided that we will be incorporating communion in the online worship service. So, long story short, I'll be putting the worship service up online probably by 10 o'clock Wednesday morning. You can come to it anytime you wish. If you'd like to take communion along with me, we have the little tiny communion cups right here with the wafer and the juice self-contained with little baggies. You can pick up however many you need for your family and take them home with you today. And we'll use those on Wednesday anytime you care to tune in. We're also going to be having communion next Sunday, which is the first Sunday of Lent. So again, communion cups are here to take home with you if you want to incorporate that in the service. If you forget, you're welcome to use juice and bread, what of your choosing at home, or simply just follow along with the liturgy, which will be a part of the Ash Wednesday service online. It'll be put up, I'll put it up online on Facebook and YouTube. So wherever you go on Wednesday, you will be able to find it. Also want to remind everybody that there's a sign-up sheet to my right, to your left, for liturgists. It's right there, and we certainly encourage anybody who would like to read the scriptures and the prayers on any Sunday to sign up for a Sunday to help out with that. Notice coming in, the little pantry supplies are starting to get down a little bit, so please thank you for your support and be continually faithful in replenishing our supplies. And I also want to thank all of our church members who do the regular faithful work of replenishing the little pantry several times a week. Thank you for that. I guess those are all the announcements I have. Is there any other announcement for the sake of the church that needs to be made at this time? We'll have prayer requests later today. Any other announcements that we should be making? All right, well then, let's begin worship by saying, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please stand for the call to worship. But before we get started, I want to take a moment and thank the choir and the rest of the congregation for your thoughts and prayers during my short bout with COVID. It was pretty mild and I feel pretty good, so thank you very much. We come into the presence of our awesome God.
Our God is robed in light and splendor and love.
The God of might and strength is the God of tender care.
We rejoice that God loves us and dwells among us.
God desires all to know of the awesome love in which they are held.
We will share God's love in our words and in our actions. Thank you.
peace of Christ.
Now it's children's time. We do have some kids here, but we don't have Buddy, my puppet, at all. He's just out enjoying the nice weather, I guess. But today is Transfiguration Sunday, and it's the last Sunday of Epiphany. Epiphany is a season of light. It starts with the January 6th, where remember the wise men following the star to Bethlehem. And throughout the weeks of Epiphany, we see shades and signs of the glory of Jesus Christ. On Transfiguration Sunday, we remember the occasion where Jesus shines the brightest of all during his earthly ministry, where he takes Peter, James, and John up to the top of a high mountain, and they see Jesus in all of his glory. It's like a bright light shines, and it's just dazzling. It's just impressive. They got me thinking about bright lights that I have. Of course, you have bright lights outside during the sunlight. When I was a kid, we used to go to the movies. And at that time, they didn't have these big multiplexes. It basically was one theater. So if you went in the afternoon and it was really, really dark outside, you'd open up the door and the sunlight would hit you. You'd go, oh, my eyes, where am I? And you would kind of be stunned for about a minute or two as your eyes got used to the sunlight. But I think when I think about light, I also think about darkness. I think about times when we have power failures. You ever have power failures in your house? And it always happens like in the middle of the night, and then all the lights go out. Where's my flashlight? Where's the flashlight? And of course, we all have phones now with flashlights, but now it's like, where's my phone? Where's my phone? And it seems so really dark. And you shine a little flashlight, and you can make your way around the house. Then eventually, if it's still out, you decide, I'm just going to go to bed. And then around 3 o'clock in the morning, all the lights come on because you didn't turn any of them on. It's a bright light. All the lights come on. I said, wow, there's the light. I was missing it so much. Well, the love of God is like that too. God is always wanting to shine the light in our hearts and in our lives. As Christy played the intro, shine, Jesus, shine. And we always want God's light to shine in us. But so many times, you see, we feel like we can be lost in the dark. That's when we have to hold each other's hands. That's why I'm glad when I have my mom and dad, when the power would go off, it would always be there. They could remind me of their love. When our boys were really tiny, they'd all just jump into bed with us. And we'd all hunker down in our queen-sized bed until the power came back on or the thunder and the lightning passed. So today's Sunday, as we look forward to the season of Lent, as we think deeper about Jesus and his love, Jesus wants us to remember that light, the remembrance of God's light, so that when things get kind of scary, when the power goes off for a while, we know that God's light is there, always flipping on the switch, always shining bright light into our eyes and into our hearts. So might the love of Jesus shine in all of our children and all of our families, and might we find this morning glory and praise to God who shines brightest of all. Amen. We'll continue now with our worship by hearing the scripture lessons for the day.
Today's epistle lesson is from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 12, and chapter 4, verse 2. Since then, we have such a hope. We act with great boldness. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statements of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. Please stand for the gospel lesson. Today's gospel lesson is the book of Luke, chapter 9, verses 28 through 40, the Transfiguration. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up to the mountain to pray. And while they were praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake and they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him, just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Not knowing what he said, while he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. Just then a man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He is my only child." Suddenly a spirit seized him, and all at once he shrieks. It convulses him until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him. "I beg your disciples to cast it out," but they could not. Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. And all were astounded at the greatness of God. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. Dear Lord, we gather here this morning awaiting your presence, needing your glory, needing your encouragement and your hope. So I pray for your Holy Spirit, give me words to preach that I might proclaim the good news that we find in Christ our Lord. We might draw us closer to you and closer to service and to love to one another. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Now, in the middle of the Transfiguration, I just want to look at this one sentence and we'll get back to it in just a minute. It says, "Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory." In the Bible, the New Revised Standard, there's a little U that says, well, look down, and it says, or it also means when they were fully awake. So, in other words, when Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but when they were fully awake, they saw his glory. When they were fully awake, they saw Jesus in his glory. Got me thinking about staying awake, sleeping through the night. Now, my little baby grandson, Blake, knows how to stay awake. He wakes up, he eats, changes diaper, then he's thirsty, eats some more, takes some more milk, goes back to sleep, wakes up several times a night, putting on some good pounds, knowing how to wake up. I used to get up with Brian, and we used to play. That was the days of MTV. I put MTV on the TV, and I would just dance with him to the music. And he's still playing music, so it wants to work. Babies know how to stay awake. Now, I do know grown-ups know how to fall asleep. The older you get, the easier it is to fall asleep just about anywhere. Even when I was a kid, when I was in college, actually, I took the bus from downtown Columbus up to campus, and the bus ride was about 20 minutes. And on the way down, I would read the paper. On the way back home, I would sleep. And I got so I could sleep for 20 minutes and wake up in time for my next bus stop to get off to go to my room on campus. But a lot of times, now, you know, Sue and I are sitting on ABO, I say, how long can we stay awake? We keep looking at each other, say, who's going to drop off first? And make sure, fortunately, we can stop the DVR or something. We'll get back to the show later or start streaming it again. But when your family gathers, you know, people are going to fall asleep. When we fall asleep to TV, people fall asleep to movies. And the hardest thing to stay awake for me is a baseball game. Because you got that, like the white noise, like, crowd. Okay, he's getting ready to pitch. Strike one. Strike two. Ball one. And just, to sleep I go. Got me thinking about, well, what's the hardest thing to stay awake for sometime? And it's the sermon during worship. I had a minister friend, and Sue was there when talking. It was really funny one time. He said, you know, Bruce, I've got these two teenagers, and you know, they say church is really boring. And you know what? They're right. Church is really boring. I thought to myself, well, who's the preacher? I'm not going to say anything to him. But how do we keep awake? Now, I think for traditional worship, which I dearly love, I'm so glad this church has traditional worship, but we do things that you might fall asleep to. We have organ music. It's nice and soft. We have something that will have silent prayer. We'll have meditative music and meditative moments to think about things. And it's hard. Sometimes you just want to just kind of rest. Now, contemporary worship on the other hand, they got a worship team, and they got the drums. They got the guitars. Let's sing praise the Lord. And we got 20 choruses, and it's everybody stand up. It wakes everybody up. So it's no surprise that people who go to those services sometimes remember the sermon better. But another thing that they have is coffee. Now don't forget to stop at the coffee bar. We got cup holders by your seat, so enjoy yourself. You're staying awake. But just staying awake, you see, doesn't mean that God necessarily is going to touch us, does it? Just staying awake is enough. There has to be something, some way in which God connects with us that fills our hearts and fills our soul and our spirit. We can't manufacture that because it's a gift from God. Jesus knows all about this, and I love the way in which the Gospel of Luke is so upfront and direct and honest about this. Jesus is trying to explain to his disciples just what's up ahead. And this section is smack dab in the middle of Luke's Gospel. It's right in the middle of Luke's Gospel. And it's the change point between Jesus is going around town and Jesus deciding to turn his face and head toward Jerusalem. He's starting his ministry, he's calling his disciples, but then there comes a decisive moment where he knows they've got to start walking toward Jerusalem. And there it is, the cross. There is the cross. So Jesus wants to explain to his disciples what they're getting in for. So he starts and talks with them earlier in this chapter. He says, well, who do people say that I am? And they say, well, some say you're Elijah, some say you're John the Baptist. Well, who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you are the Lord. You are the Messiah of God. And Jesus is very, you know, he remarks, well said, but let me explain to you what's coming up for me as Messiah. And he goes on to say, well, the Son of Man must undergo great suffering, be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the scribes, be killed, and on the third day he'll be raised. And if you want to be my disciples, you've got to pick up your cross and follow me. Heavy duty stuff. But Jesus says there's going to come a time when the Son of Man will come back in glory. You will see the Son of Man's, you will see glory. We're going to have to walk through these dark and difficult days. And up to the mountain they go. Boom, the transfiguration, bright light. Jesus is there. There's Moses, you know, the great lawgiver, Elijah, the great prophet. They're there with Jesus, and the disciples are sleeping. They're sleeping. Peter wakes up, and it says, Luke says, and he didn't know what he was saying. He goes, I'm going to recreate the moment for you so you can relish it. There's Jesus. There's Moses. There's Elijah. Hey, why don't we just have three tents up here and you guys can just hang out forever? Now, we don't usually hear that way, but I thought, if I'm just waking up from sleep, is it a dream? Is it real? And what's interesting in this story, it's like, well, this sounds pretty good. You know, three places, you know, places we could have a big worship center. But the one who interrupts it is God. God interrupts the whole thing. I better stand in the camera here. Sorry, folks, if you're viewing, I get away from time to time. A great cloud comes over and it darkens the sea. God interrupts Peter's foolishness and speaks out with a loud voice, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." This catches their attention. This seals the deal. When the voice is spoken, Jesus was found alone, and Peter, James, and John had an experience that they would never, ever forget. They don't really know what to say. Jesus does not encourage them to share it. Let's go back down the mountainside. They go back down the mountainside, and you've had this wonderful, glorious experience that, okay, now we know that Jesus has God's glory with him. We know that he's destined to be the Messiah. They come down, what did they see? But they see the other disciples failing to cast out a demon. Now, the Gospel of Luke is very clear that Jesus already sent out the disciples to preach and teach, to heal, and to cast out demons. They can do that because they go with the authority of God through Jesus. Jesus has given the power to do this, and they've done it in the past, but they just can't get the demon out of this kid. Now, the thing with this little boy is that he has, back there in Bible times, they did believe in demons. They believed that there were just difficult times and difficult maladies that you didn't really know how to cure it. You just would pray that it would change, that things would leave a person. And this does resemble epilepsy. It says he's foaming at the mouth, he's shrapping, just going all over the place. And other parts of the Bible, they'll have a little thing, the boy with epilepsy. Jesus cures the boy with epilepsy. But epilepsy is not a concept back in Bible times. We read in Matthew's Gospel, the Greek word literally translates, he was moonstruck. And the Latin version of moonstruck is lunatic. Lunatic. He was crazy. He was possessed by a demon. The Bible doesn't get into all kinds of reasons for causes for this thing, except the Bible wants us to know that Jesus healed this boy. Jesus healed the boy. But before the healing comes, Jesus says these words that are heartbreaking. And I believe he's looking at his disciples. He says, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you?" He's heartbroken. He says something that actually is very human. How much longer must I bear with you? How much longer must I try to convince you of my glory? Convince you that you are following God's love? And the truth of the matter is, of course, he's going to have other incidents with the disciples, but they're still not going to understand it. But it's here for us, because God reveals God's glory to us in so many ways. So many ways. When we baptize a baby, when we attend a wedding, when we have a family gathering, when we're involved feeding the poor, when we're involved speaking out for justice, when we're involved speaking out for LGBTQI people, when we're speaking out for peace in the Ukraine, when we're speaking out for love and mercy, God's light shines bright. But when we move away from that light, when we encounter something that seems bigger than we can handle, when a child in our family dies, when somebody has a terrible automobile accident, when somebody is dealing with abject poverty, when somebody loses their job or loses their home through flood, through bombings, through hardship, when refugees just travel, thousands and thousands of refugees leave a war-torn country, it's easy to feel as though the cloud is very dark. But the Transfiguration says it's out of the cloud that God speaks, it's out of the cloud that God reminds us that God is present with us. Well, you see, this passage for me just reveals the fact that as we celebrate Transfiguration Sunday and we go into maybe the darker days of Lent and we think about Jesus' sacrifice for us and for the world, we need to remember Christ in all of his glory. We need to remember Jesus Christ in his fullness. We need to remember that God's light is shining in all those places. That's why during Lent, if you take on another spiritual practice or if you give something up for Lent, use these days to think about God and God's love and God's power and God's peace. And as we think about these things, we can stay awake. We stay awake because we're anticipating God's presence. We're anticipating that we're going to see God. And if we're looking for God's love, you will see God's love. God's love is everywhere. We forget to look at it. We get confused and afraid. In Paul's letter to the church of Corinth, he says, talking about us and our calling as disciples, he says, all of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in the mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Or as Charles Wesley paraphrases in one of his famous hymns, change from glory into glory till in heaven we take our place, till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and praise. We are to be changed from glory into glory. And to do that, we need to reflect the glory of Jesus Christ. So I encourage us all, each and every day, to take the rest that we need, to find peace and rest in God, but to stay awake. Stay awake to see God's love in every occasion, because the world needs to see God's love too. Jesus Christ has given us the power to pray and heal and teach in His name. Jesus Christ has given us the power to be the body of Christ, to be the church for the world. Jesus Christ has given us His power to be Jesus Christ for the world. Thanks be to God for that kind of love. Let us not always fall asleep, but when we wake up, when we become really aware of God's presence, let us take that love and share it with the world. Amen. Let's join now in singing our hymn of response. Christ is the world's light.
Please be seated.
We come now to a time of prayer, but before I offer the pastoral prayer, we'd like to have a time to share joys and concerns. Again, we're very happy to have Robert Falcone here after his bout with COVID, and reminds us that many members of this congregation have experienced COVID and have seen their way through. So we're very thankful for that, but we pray for all the other people with harder times with COVID, and those who have lost people to the COVID, the people who are still struggling with their health concerns. We want to lift up the Ukraine, of course, not only the Ukrainian people, but the Russian people. We've been reminded there is a protest and rage around the country, including thousands of Russians who would like to see a peaceful resolution and for the troops to leave the Ukraine. So pray for the citizens of the Ukraine, refugees, and a large Ukrainian population in America. There's a large Ukrainian portion of Parma, Ohio, south of Cleveland, where we lived for a while. Keep the Ukrainian Orthodox Church and all the people with family in the Ukraine in our prayers as well. Also, I continue to lift up prayers for Devin's granddaughter, Zoe. Keep her in our prayers and pray for more days of encouragement. We also wanted, she has raised up the Sexton family. We want to remember them in our prayers. And I mentioned my friends Mark and Debbie before. I keep them in my prayers. Debbie is still having a very rough time following a very intense chemotherapy for metastasized cancer. So please keep Debbie in your prayers and pray for healing and hope for her. Are there other names or concerns you'd like to raise today? Please yes, Jenny.
I'd like prayers for my friend Melanie and her family. I heard from her this morning. Her father passed away this morning.
Okay, please remember Melanie and her family upon her father passing away this morning. Pray for God to be with them. Are there other Perkins or just Chuck?
Please continue to pray for Nancy and for her wellness. And let's pray to God that things will turn out well.
Amen. We'll keep Nancy Lingle in our prayers. Recovering from surgery is always a very challenging thing. And we need to remember when people come home from the hospital to keep them in our prayers, because so much of the recovery is hard work and they need the support not only of family and friends, but with therapists and others. Are there other prayer concerns? Well, then let us pray. Remember these as well as others in our hearts and minds. Dear Lord, we come here this morning because we need you. We come here this morning because we need your love, your guidance, and your care. We come here this morning because we want to care for one another. We want to be actively in love with the world. So I pray for Holy Spirit to touch our hearts and our minds through the hymns, through the prayers, through the scripture, through the sermon. Whatever ways you can, remind us that you are with us and that we can rest in your arms. We pray today for so many people in need of healing. We want to lift up Nancy Lingo, Debbie Baker, Mark Owen. We want to lift up the Sexton family. We want to pray for you to continue to be with Zoe and help her in her development and be with all of our children as they return to school and as they deal with all kinds of challenges. We pray for Melanie and her family upon the loss of her dad. We ask for you to surround them with your presence. Be with their family members and friends as they gather together to support them at this great loss. We pray for all those living with COVID, including ourselves, and we thank you so much for walking with us these past couple of years. We pray not only for Newtown United Methodist Church, but for every church in our communities and for those who listen to this sermon and this worship of other churches. We pray for them. We lift up Bishop Greg Palmer, and we lift up all the pastors who are preparing to retire, the pastors are preparing to relocate, because indeed this is the season of the church where interviews are made. So we pray for them as well. We pray also for our changing communities. We also pray most of all for your love to be seen in us. Help our love to be so strong and so bright and so genuine that we might not only encourage ourselves to be more bold in our love, but that we might persuade those who do not know you that your love is real, because they see it through us. Help us to give our food, our time, our love, our support to one our neighbors, and for the neighbors we have yet to meet, the friends we have yet to know. Continue to watch over us, use us to your greatest ability, and help us always to find our rest in you. Give us love to share, and then remind us that we need to share it. For in so sharing it, your love can grow. Bless us and keep us. Be with the people of the Ukraine. Be with our troops. Be with the NATO forces. Be with all the citizens who are praying and working for peace. We pray for an end for this violence. We pray for this end of this oppression. We pray for your love to reign supreme. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's join now in praying the prayer that Jesus taught to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now at this time, as you present your offering envelopes and the offering tray at the front of the chancel, we also take this time to listen to an offertory anthem to give us reason to praise and thank God for all that God's given us to share with the world. Let's join now in listening to the choir offertory, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
salvation. Your steadfast love surrounds those who trust you. And we are grateful that you nurture us with your word. By your Spirit, help our congregation to draw closer to you as we reach out to share your good news with our neighbors. We dedicate our tithes and offerings in the name of your faithful Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We have found within us the dwelling place of God.
Amen.
Amen.